Wendy N. Wagner, and I'm reading today from my short story that will be appearing in the anthology 18, edited by Mark Hippo and published by Underland Press. The story was inspired by two pretty common bumper stickers, at least they're common around here. One says, "When guns are outlawed, only outlaws will have guns." The other says, "I support the right to arm bears." This is what happened when those two bumper stickers had a baby. It's called, "When Only Bears Carry Arms, Only Weapons Will Be Born." The bears walked through the streets with their long black rifles. We were powerless against them. They had the guns and we did not, and thus the world was theirs. At night, we could hear them at target practice, the neighborhood cats screaming in fear and pain. How the bears managed their weapons was a trivial mystery. How their flat, brutal paws could grip the stock of a gun, their claws work a trigger, their black tongues slot bullets into the chambers. We did not worry about those things. This was the time of the big snow, after all. There were plenty of other things to worry about. I lay in my bed worrying how I could keep my littlest sister from getting frostbite, and also wondering, very quietly and only to myself, what I would do when I was no longer a girl. Those nights were long and cold and lonely. Once we had kept a dog who liked to snuggle on my bed when the lights were off, but the bears had driven away all the dogs on that same gray day they rounded up the intellectuals and shot them beneath the bridges. The bears were dangerous, but not as dangerous as night felt after our dog disappeared. The guns were dangerous, but not as dangerous as the women hissing and growling behind the black bars of their bridge prisons. The culverts diverting creeks and streams throughout the city boundaries echoed with their rage, and the train bridges, no longer used for travel, shook as if 1,000 trolls hungered for billy goats. Most of the mothers succumbed to fear and took in bear lodgers in exchange for food. Their daughters did not leave their houses to seek out the vegetables forgotten in abandoned gardens. The yards filled up with snow, the ice packing between the neat little pickets of the fences and glowing blue when the snow played on it. My sisters and I beat paths between the yards of such girls and ignored their faces at the windows as we cut blocks of ice away from the sleeping earth. They never spoke or called to us, although one time I found a purple woolen scarf draped over an ice-sculptured birdbath and footprints leading back up to the porch. I gave the scarf to Dora, the littlest of my sisters. She wrapped it around her shining blonde head, giggling to herself as a little girl will do. She was young enough to still love presents, and this year we had not been able to give her any on her birthday. The bears had taken all the childish things for themselves. "Mind Elise now, she'll know how to keep you safe in the woods," I said. Dora giggled again, and then Elise appeared on the front steps carrying their collecting baskets. "Come and take your basket, Dora," she grumbled. Elise's temper, like her hair, was fiery. Francine opened the door and waited patiently for Dora to take her basket and adjust her gloves and then beg me to fix her scarf, which had fallen over her eyes. "Are you sure you won't want to come with us, Aunt Gwendolyn?" I spared her a smile. Of all of us, Francine was the kindest. Her black eyes always brightened when she could give Dora the biggest carrot or when she could sneak a little drawing under Mother's place setting before Mother sat down to breakfast. She cried for a month when the bears took our dog, and she always slept with a pillow over her head so as to muffle gunfire. "You'll be all right, Franny. Mother asked me especially to check the river, and I can't let her down." Francine tied her crackling black curls back with a scarf I once gave to Mother. "Please be careful." She hurried down the stairs to press a kiss on my cheek. "If you change your mind, you know where to find me." I nodded. If I get done soon enough. I doubted I would. The pond where Francine was headed to search out cattail root sat on the other side of town, just past the empty field where the bears took their revolvers. The younger girls were too terrified of the empty casings to even skirt the edges of that place, but Francine feared nothing. That was why Mother sent me to the river. A little fear could keep a girl safe. I would find more than cattails on the riverbanks, of course. When the tides changed, sometimes the river left us treasures of faraway places and times, and it was those things Mother wanted. The barely edible cattail roots were merely an excuse. She hungered for pieces of the past. The past my sisters and I could barely remember, despite the fact it lay just behind our shadows. The snow had buried that too. It took me most of an hour to make my way through the town and down to the river, avoiding the tavern through the bears growled over beers, and carefully skirting the rumbling bridges. The path wound and twisted through thickets and abandoned schools, but it felt safe, at least during the day. I don't think any of us would have taken it in the dark, not even Francine. The river smelled of mud now, the tide drawing its waters down to the faded green weeds. Shards of ice clacked on the rocks, broken into music by the tug of the ocean. Somewhere out there, the sea hunkered on its beach, winding up its nets of rivers and creeks, drawing all the world's loose bits to itself. I could picture her as something like my mother, a big brown woman with brown shoulders and tough, broad, knuckled hands. We used to drive to the beach in the summer. I could remember that. The warm sun, the shrieking gulls, the strong grip of my father's hand on mine. I wiped the cold from my eyes and picked my way down to the rocks. Mother sometimes brought us fish from the river, but the bears had learned to watch her closely and take anything she found for themselves. They cared nothing for us girls as long as we kept quiet and ignored their eyes on our legs and backs. The wind played over the river, stirring its surface into white teeth. My fingers burned with the cold as I picked through the worthless things left in the mud. Plastic bits, unidentifiable and half-bleached of color, a cracked sand pail, a rubber squeegee, or perhaps a windshield wiper. There had been cars once, I remembered. Perhaps the snow had buried them and made them worthless, or perhaps, like the trains, the bears had destroyed them. Boats and planes and bicycles were likewise gone, so now feet alone we had. The arms, of course, belonged to the bears. A little whitish box caught my attention. I worked it out from between two rocks. Needles, I read on the plastic label. I opened the box, expecting only rusty water, but found everything snug and dry inside, the needles winking sleepily in the night. Good find, then. We were all learning to sew. I picked up a small, handsome tin, thinking Mother might find a use for it in her workshop, and then I dug a few cattails of roots. There in the reeds, I caught a surprise flash of blue and snatched it up, a small ball of yarn. Not even enough for a Dora-sized sock, but perhaps worth something when mixed with the other fragments we had around the house. I lined my basket with leaves and laid all my damp and muddy river finds on the neat green lining. The sun wouldn't stay in the sky much longer. I hesitated there on the riverbank. The winding path I had taken earlier would put me in the way of the bears as they left the taverns for target practice. I could avoid them if I took a few shortcuts around the old playground, but that would certainly mean getting home after dark. Alternately, I could follow the old bike trail. Sometimes I struggled to remember just what those words even meant, where it followed Tinker Creek under a bridge. The trail divided from the creek by a neat railing. It would be a quick, dry walk under the bridge into the heart of the town, and I could very likely meet my sister's home. Turned to face the trail going under the bridge. The deck of the bridge stood 10 or 15 feet above it, allowing enough light for safety. No snow had found its way beneath the bridge, and no ice glinted on the path. But a few feet up the sloping sides of the bridge's embankments, heavy bars cut off the darkest hollows, creating the little space between the bridge where the intellectuals squatted in their half-life. Goosebumps rose up on my arms. Even before the snow, people had warned us about the intellectuals. Some women had even cheered when the bears shut them away, and now no one besides my mother and sisters would speak of the prisoners. I drew my shawl more tightly around me and wished I had a coat that fit. I took a small step forward and heard a tiny chink. There at the end of the path lay a gold flip-top lighter, brighter than the sun. I snatched it up. This had not come out of the river. This could only have dropped out of the pocket of some patrolling bear. To be found with it would be risk being used for target practice myself. But Mother would certainly want it. Whatever she built in her workshop, kept secret even from us girls, it could only be improved by something as dangerous as this. I slid it under the top layer of leaves in my basket, my mind made up. With that lighter on me, I'd rather face a dozen trollish intellectuals than one patrolling bear. So I hurried down the bike trail and under the bridge, The snow might not have found its way onto the path, but the cold had. Here, where the sun never really intruded, the cold gathered itself in damp folds, the creek hissing quietly beneath its frozen skin. My boots skidded on the kind of ice that cannot be seen, invisible and nasty. I caught at the railing and felt the iron bite at the top layer of my skin. Not so safe after all this path.
Girl! Hey! Girl!
I wish I could pretend my footfalls covered up the voice, but despite its dry grate, I heard it well enough. Keeping my grip on the cold railing, I turned my head very slowly to the left. 4 or 5 feet up the embankment, black bars held a deeper darkness that swallowed the underside of the bridge. Can you please help us? If you want to know what happens next to Gwendolyn, the intellectuals, and the flip-top gold lighter, you're gonna have to check out this anthology. I'll put all the information in the comments below. Thanks so much.